President Frattini, thank you very much for talking to us. You have been Italy's Minister of Foreign Affairs for two terms. You also have a long experience with the European Union. Today you are the President of the Italian Society for International Organization, the Italian Association for the United Nations. President Trump has announced that he does not intend to continue the nuclear agreement with Iran as is. The European Union instead has defended the agreement. In what direction do you think Italy should go?
Italy certainly has extremely important and historic ties with the United States. And of course, Italy has a friendship with the State of Israel, which probably has, in Italy, its closest ally in the European Union. So we understand the concerns that led President Trump to his decision. On the other hand, Italy always has been, within the European Union, a country that has worked to reach reasonable compromises and to avoid steps that could be irreversible. Therefore, we pay close attention to the reasons why the U.S. did not certify the agreement with Iran. In some cases, they are serious reasons. Obviously, I believe it is of common interest, both for Europe and America, to work toward a more transparent deal and more cooperation from Iran.
Why does the current agreement not work?
There are aspects that put too much power in Iranian hands, especially when it comes to evaluating Iran's compliance with the deal and its progress with a nuclear research program that must have no military aims. Such verification is heavily entrusted to Iran itself, which obviously is interested, or may be interested, in hiding something. Perhaps also the agreement provides too little in terms of external mechanisms of inspecting Iran's activities. We always have supported the IAEA's inspection duties, but this agreement has somewhat emptied the agency's role. So probably what would need to be reviewed in the deal are these aspects of inspections and transparency. I believe also that, ultimately, the U.S. is interested in Iran being part of a solution rather than part of a problem. So the pure and simple isolation of Iran would be rather negative and dangerous. All of us should look for a win-win situation, in which we in the West are more confident that transparency is guaranteed, and in which the Iranians get to maintain relations with us as they work to avoid destabilizing the Middle East. They shouldn't help rebels in Yemen to fight against the Yemeni government or use Hezbollah with the purpose of attacking or destroying Israel. It's clear to me that this destabilizing activity of Iran must end.
Mr. Franco Frattini received us in the office of the Italian Society for International Organizations or Italian Association for the United Nations that he heads in Rome. As Italy's foreign affairs minister between 2002 and 2004, and again from 2008 to 2011, Mr. Frattini came to know Iran and Iranian leaders very well. He told VOA that Europe and the United States should work together to improve the deal with Iran and not to cut off contact with Tehran.
The International Atomic Energy Agency said that based on the inspections it has carried out, Iran is in compliance with the agreement. Do you think it would be appropriate to apply the inspections to Iranian military sites?
Well, this is a key point. Of course, we should look at places where we are concerned that nuclear power is in use, such as the military sites. We could only inspect medical research facilities or hospitals where surely there is nuclear research activity for medical purposes. But we have to go look where we suspect something is wrong. That is, inside the military sites.
You said that in order for us to be safe, this nuclear deal would need to be amended or be followed up by a new agreement in the future. Instead, would having no agreement at all with Iran make the world safer?
No, it wouldn't. I believe an agreement with Iran is necessary. As I said before, Iran might be part of a bigger problem. We should make it possible that it becomes part of a solution. It is enough to think of Iraq, for example, where the Shiite influence is vast, and Iran's intervention through the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps is no secret. The same applies to Syria and to the Iranian presence on the ground there, through Hezbollah and the IRGC. There also are Iran's terrible tensions with Saudi Arabia. All of this makes me think that an agreement with Iran is needed. But it must be a mutually beneficial agreement. I believe that some work could be done on the current agreement to strengthen it and to make its implementation more transparent.
The President of the United States said that the agreement is not in the interests of America and that a broader strategy is needed. What do you think are the interests of Europe and Italy?
As a matter of fact, Europe is closer than America to this theater of crisis. Our concern is that a destabilized Middle East may impact us more easily. We also are well aware of the historical bonds that Italy has with Russia, and the fact that Russia, Turkey, or Iran might play and do play a role in the Syrian conflict. So a short circuit between all these countries might be a big problem for Europe.
Per l'Europa è un problema grande.
As the region is just a 2-hour flight from us, not a 10-hour flight, as is the case for Washington. Therefore, of course, our interest is to seek an agreement and a compromise. A compromise that should be reasonable and reassuring, though.
Let's talk about solutions. How do we ask Iran to stop its intervention in the Middle East?
First of all, we should ask Iran to support a transition in the Syrian regime. Today, everybody knows that Russia wasn't willing any longer to defend Assad at any cost, and only Tehran continues to be a staunch and uncompromising defender of the Syrian regime. So we should ask Iran first not to oppose a possible gradual transition from Assad to a national unity government. Secondly, let's avoid this situation in Yemen. The Iranians say that it is Saudi Arabia's fault, but I believe both governments are to blame. We should restore hope for Yemen. This means that Iranian-backed Shiite militias should avoid pushing into other Yemeni regions. Third, we should work to consolidate Iraq in the post-ISIS era.
Post-Daesh, post-ISIS, perché Baghdad.
Given that the government in Baghdad clearly listens to Tehran. If that consultation becomes a continuous Iranian interference, well, we no longer know whether in Baghdad there is an Iraqi government or an Iranian governor. We want the Iraqi government to be strong and autonomous. They now have the problem of Iraqi Kurdistan. Iran should avoid fanning the flames of that crisis. The same goes with Palestine. After the reconciliation agreement between Fatah and Hamas, Iran should stop pushing Hamas to launch missiles against Israel. All of these behaviors are not in the nuclear agreement, but should be part of a new deal that I think Iran should be called around a table to discuss.
Could Italy and Europe afford Iran having ballistic missiles?
Absolutamente no.
Absolutely not. As I said, a missile could reach some European countries in 1.5 hours. So it is clear that our concern absolutely is about security. I always have been one of the strongest advocates of a common European defense. We lack an integrated European defense alongside the NATO shield.
Una difesa europea ben integrata.
It would be terribly necessary because the southern shores of the Mediterranean are likely to explode, needless to say, with migratory flows being dramatic.
Sono un fenomeno drammatico.
And to the southeast, there is a Middle East which looks like a powder keg.
In your opinion, should a new negotiation with Iran include this as well?
I think we also should talk about ballistic missiles, because ballistic missiles, even without nuclear warheads, are enough to devastate an entire city. All these experiments, these tests that unfortunately Iran is carrying out, show that where you have to look is the military sites. That said, when a country has a well-functioning ballistic missile, then mounting a nuclear warhead on it is pretty easy.
Italy is one of the biggest trade partners of Iran and has signed many agreements in the railway sector, for example. Bilateral trade has increased threefold in 2017. In your view, should Italy support a hard line like the US that would endanger its investments in Iran?
Look, I'll be honest. As Minister of Foreign Affairs in 2008 to 2009, when Ahmadinejad was in power in Iran, the whole world agreed on sanctions, and I had no hesitation to withdraw Italy from commercial agreements with Iran, which had a great cost to our economy. But we did it. Today, Italy will not move away from the European position either. Let me be clear about this. The Atlantic loyalty, the historic friendship with the United States, does not make us forget that we have a European position that we must refer to. As the Germans are the top trade partner of Iran, what I hope is that Germany, the United Kingdom, France, and Italy will find a common position. Frankly speaking, the loyalty to America has cost us dearly. Sanctions against Russia, for example, which Italy does not want, and I repeat, does not want, cost Italy 3 billion euros a year in terms of lost trade. Yet, we accept it. Our American friends must understand that a dialogue with Europe is indispensable. It is obvious that we cannot ask our businessmen and our economies to commit suicide. It has taken so long to restart our economic growth. I believe that a solution can be found by restarting a U.S.-Europe dialogue on new terms for a deal, such as more inspections, certainly more attention to Iranian military sites and not just civilian ones, and urging Iran to make some geostrategic gestures in the Middle East.
If the U.S. Congress decides to bring American sanctions to the highest level, or even if President Trump uses his own authority to end the Iran agreement, and Europe, on the other hand, maintains the deal,
Do you think that this would create a split between Europe and the United States, which perhaps was the Iranian idea all along? How would you judge this scenario?
I think this may happen. It could be the case, and I say this with concern. We should prevent the two partners, the United States and Europe, from acting without prior consultation. I think Europe could not follow the orders of an American Congress that says, since we apply sanctions, you have to apply them too. But the preventive dialogue needs to be restarted. It is absent today. The U.S. has no better ally than Europe, and honestly, Europe does not have a better ally than the U.S. If the European Parliament decides tomorrow that the agreement with Iran stays on, whatever happens, that certainly cannot bind the U.S. Congress. But at the same time, any decision by the U.S. Congress certainly cannot bind us. So before any resolution by the U.S. Congress or the European Parliament, diplomacy should be put to work.
Despite pressures, the U.S. president did not ask to define the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps as a terrorist organization. Many have said that this is the way to go, even if it would be an unprecedented measure. What do you think?
Look, President Trump has impressed us on many occasions with his decisions, some expected and some unexpected. I would have imagined a Trump decision in this case not to define the Revolutionary Guards as a terrorist organization. That is because I believe Trump always takes a step further than the status quo, but without breaking the thread, so to speak. I was the Italian Foreign Affairs Secretary who promoted Hamas's designation as a terrorist organization. And Europe followed Italy's position unanimously. It was in 2003, during my first mandate. I know how it works with these things. Placing the IRGC on a blacklist would mean labeling an official part of the Iranian regime as terrorist. That would be tantamount to a pre-war situation. I think the U.S. could not afford that.
It was believed by supporters of the Iran deal that an economic opening to Iran would strengthen reformists. Has that happened? And isn't this hard line coalescing Iranians around a more conservative position?
I hoped that the reformists would be strengthened, but unfortunately, it did not happen. During my first mandate as Foreign Affairs Secretary, President Khatami had a majority in the Iranian parliament, which was much closer to his moderate and reformist position. Then, the obscure era of Ahmadinejad came. I had hopes that the current president, Rouhani, would win a second mandate, thanks to the economic growth and the normalization of international relations that he has started, but the conservative forces have put such a normalization in question and claimed that economic benefits are not a priority. What is most important to them is to affirm Iranian regional power. So, unfortunately, Rouhani works with a parliament that is extremely conservative, or at least a large part of it. When Rouhani was voted in the first time, I met him at the United Nations General Assembly in New York. When he arrived, he started speaking with the press and in English. It was incredible, a sign of utmost opening. Today, he does not do such things anymore.
Thank you.
Thanks to you.